Welcome, everyone, to the 21st meeting of the Devolution Further Powers Committee. Can remind all members present to switch off their phones. I welcome our panel of witnesses and welcome to any other witnesses to today's proceedings. We have apologies from two of our members, from Stuart Maxwell and from Duncan McNeill. There are no substitutions on this occasion. Agenda item one is decision on taking items of business in private, and therefore do we agree to taking items three, consideration of evidence heard, four, the summary note of our away day, and five, our citizen's guide in private. Okay, thank you very much. In that case, we now move to agenda item two on the Scotland Bill. This is another one of our sessions in taking further evidence on the Scotland Bill prior to its consideration at the House of Commons at report stage. And we have today a panel of academic witnesses, Aileen McCarg, who is Professor of Public Law and Department of Law at Strathclyde University, Iain McLean, who is Professor of Politics at Nuffield College, Oxford University, Andrew Tickell, the Lecturer of Department of Law at Glasgow Caledonian University. Thank you very much for coming along. We're very grateful for you giving us some of your time as we continue to deliberate the Scotland Bill before the report stage. Can I start with a question specifically to Professor McLean, as I think it starts the discussion up nicely. And I see the other two of you sighing a sigh of relief. Sorry, Iain. But I was very interested in the views you've expressed in your submission about the balance between the taxes being devolved and those reserved and the ability of a future Scottish Parliament to pay for a different set of economic and social policies in Scotland compared to other parts of the UK. If that's what we want to do, things like abolishing the tuition fees or, for instance, bedroom tax. So my question is whether the balance in this bill is right between the risk and rewards for the risks that are being transferred, for example, being responsible in part for the provision of the Scottish welfare system. Are we getting the right rewards in terms of either extra financial powers, policy flexibility, and in that light, how important does the fiscal framework become?
thank you, Convener. Do I need to press? No.
Fine.
Thank you, Convener. Neither the UK Parliament nor this Parliament seems to me to be an entirely free agent in this matter, because what we're seeing is a bill to implement the recommendations of the Smith Commission, and the Smith Commission proposed a certain balance of tax powers and spending powers, and that more or less is what this bill proposes. As members will have seen in my written evidence, there are some things which I think are good to the extent to which it reduces vertical fiscal imbalance, which I define in my notes and I'm happy to talk further about. But then there are other aspects, which I think is because of the political process of Smith, which are rather confused, so that a rather, in my opinion, random set of welfare powers are put into the bill, and then powers to top up other welfare spending. You asked about the balance of risk and reward, and I think the issue there is that this bill contains powers on the upside, but not on the downside. The risk in any further tax devolution is that tax receipts in Scotland go up by less than tax receipts in the rest of the UK. The bill contains powers to top up spending. It doesn't contain powers to reduce spending. So that risk, in my view, transmits into the risk that the Scottish Parliament might face a funding crunch somewhere towards the end of the spending review period that's about to start. I would prefer if risk and reward were more balanced in the ways that I suggest in my notes. If you're devolving welfare powers, in my view, you should also devolve some welfare tax powers, and then the risk and the reward both sit with the Scottish Parliament. At present, some of the risk is in one place and some of the risk is in another.
Can you let me widen it out and so that others can take part in this discussion as well? And can I give you a specific example where, in the area of welfare, that hopefully open up into other welfare issues that I know Linda Fabiani wants to get into? We had a submission to the Welfare Reform Committee from Professor David Bell, who pointed out a possible flaw in the risk-reward balance, and that's why I opened up with that question, Iain. if you don't get agreements between the two governments right. When the powers for DLA, carers allowance, etc. are transferred, we'll receive about £2.5 billion to pay for these benefits. But unless we uprate each year at the correct rate, the fact that our population is ageing quicker than the rest of the UK means that demand may outstrip the revenues that are being provided. So unless we get it right and have more ability to boost tax revenues from elsewhere through deeper or a deeper basket of taxes devolved, or indeed make sure we've got a right balancing agreement in the fiscal framework, we could be potentially looking at a poison chalice, for want of a better description. I just want to get your thoughts on that, and maybe I've described it a bit too strongly, but you can see where I'm going.
Thank you, Convener. Is poison chalice, may I ask, David Bell's language or your
no,
own?
No, it's mine.
David Bell knows what he's talking about, and although I haven't seen his evidence, it seems to me that's very likely to be right. And I think poison chalice is a perfectly appropriate phrase because of the general point that I made earlier. If Scottish tax receipts do not go up in proportion to spending liabilities, then it is indeed a poison chalice.
Oh, could you also, in that, before I come to Aileen and Andrew, reflect on how we might use the fiscal framework to allow a balancing process that could create the environment where that situation wouldn't develop?
Well,
is it possible?
I'm sure it's possible, Convener. Ministers talk about using tax powers to grow the economy. I think they may be a wee bit optimistic there. I do, however, think that the area where this Parliament has already shown some initiatives and where there is the most potential is in relation to land and property taxation, where this Parliament has already stepped away from the Westminster framework. And in my view, and I've separately given evidence to the Tax Reform Commission, which I could refer members to, in my view, there is scope there.
Okay. Aileen, Andrew?
I don't know a huge amount about tax, so I'm going to. I don't have a lot to add. I mean, I would say, I suppose, that the general view, and this seems to be borne out by experience, is that the income tax is a difficult tax to. It's a difficult tax to raise. Other taxes are easier to raise, and the wider basket of taxes you have, you know, the greater flexibility you have. I think there's other issues also about. And this is sort of wider than welfare. We have to understand tax not merely as a revenue-raising instrument, but also as a regulatory instrument designed to alter behaviour. So the fewer tax powers you have, the less flexibility you have in other areas as well. The failure to devolve taxes can alter the balance of risk and reward on substantive policy areas. And Iain has mentioned in his submission, you talked about onshore oil and gas taxation. And I think there's an interesting issue there around about the political incentives that creates in relation to allowing fracking, for instance. You know, if the Scottish Government is not going to get any of the rewards from allowing fracking, and if fracking, as we know, is highly controversial, then I think that sort of tips the balance a little bit in terms of the substantive policy decision as to whether you decide to allow fracking. So, you know, I think, you know, we have to understand tax in that broader policy sense and not merely as a revenue raising instrument.
Andrew?
Yeah, all I would say, I mean, I'm not a tax lawyer either or particularly good with numbers in general, but I would say that it's one of the challenges this committee faces, I think, is that we have a dual process here. You have a process for framing the Scotland Bill, which sets out what powers this Parliament will or will not have. And then you have, as you described it, a parallel set of negotiations between the governments about the fiscal relationships, about how Smith's principle of no detriment might be realised. And in the sense, just looking at the bill doesn't tell us that. It doesn't tell us how that level of negotiation is going between the UK government and the Scottish government, and whether it does actually sort of hit the right balance in distributing resources across this country. So I think that's one of the big challenges for us. It's hard to analyse, I think, the bill in isolation.
Does it not also constrain us in terms of policy flexibility? And I think you described some of that in your own paper as well, Andrew. You want to expand some of that?
In terms of tax
and welfare,
or,
in particular.
Yeah, well, I think my criticisms of the bill were largely premised on how it's drafted in terms of the powers, as opposed to the interaction between taxation and welfare. I mean, my basic starting point, my basic principle here is to ask: well, are the restrictions which are placed on powers intelligible? Are they sensible? Are they necessary? And if they're not necessary, then they shouldn't be there. I think, in the context for me, we're talking about the Scottish Parliament. Is a constrained legislature. It's not like Westminster. We're not transferring welfare powers from Westminster to Holyrood, because Holyrood is subject to judicial review in ways that Westminster isn't. Westminster is a sovereign parliament, and welfare policy made by Westminster, generally speaking, can't be challenged in the way that acts of this parliament can be. And it's around those areas, I think, that I'm particularly concerned about some of the definitions around welfare in the Scotland Bill, that they're very likely to give rise to litigation, they're likely to limit your ability to make policy on things like disability, on things like carers, and I think that's unnecessary.
Okay. I think that leads probably into Linda then, in terms of some of the other
issues. Yeah. I think there's two issues here, Andrew, that picked up from your paper and relative to what Bruce has been saying. Is, first of all, that what I consider to be a lack of cohesion amongst all the different elements of what we have in the Scotland Bill. And I think that's particularly stark when it comes to the welfare issues. I have a real concern that when we move from talking about the theory of all this, how it happens and all the disagreements, that at the end of the day we've got people who may well find that their lives are even more messed up than they have been over the last while with welfare. I was interested, Andrew, in what you were talking about, the difference between the Smith report saying that Holyrood would have complete autonomy in determining the structure and value of benefits for certain things, and then what you mentioned to the convener about the restrictive way in this has been applied. The definitions, particularly about specifying who should be classed as disabled, specifying who should be classed as a carer, and the potential ongoing long-term argument between institutions that ends up with people in the middle having a really hard time. Have you been able, as an academic, to work out the logic in why this is being applied and why it's so different from what was clearly the intent of the Smith Commission?
Well, I think it's probably because my understanding is that the first draft of this bill was written by the Treasury, and that begins to explain quite a lot about how it's drafted and the sort of control freakery of it. In the sense, I mean, take the example of how we define a carer. What interest does the Westminster government have in defining carers' benefits as belonging and being able to be paid only to people over the age of 16, not in work and not in education? I mean, is it accepted universally forever and for all time that this parliament, for example, wouldn't want to give extra support to 14-year-olds who care for their relatives? I don't understand really what the prevailing interest is of the Westminster Parliament in specifying that, and what is to be gained really in terms of constraining the policy autonomy of this parliament. And as you see, if in future a government comes along, a party comes along who wants to challenge that and say, for example, give payments to 14-year-old carers, we have another Section 30 under the Scotland Act, another set of reform. This is meant to be a stable settlement. I don't think it realises that.
Yeah, which leads me on, Aileen, to one of the things you were saying in relative to the new welfare benefits and devolved areas. I was interested, Andrew, that you said that, in your opinion, it would quite clearly have been started by the Treasury, that kind of discussion. Because we have the Smith Commission recommendation about the power to create new benefits within areas of devolved responsibility. That was quite clear. And then we now have a Secretary of State for Scotland who is saying, well, actually, that's just silly because you already have that. And if we assume that that begins from the Treasury, well, the Treasury sat there all the way through the Smith Committee negotiations, and without giving too much away, I think we were rather constrained at times, Tavish, by some of the Treasury opinions. Tavish. So again, I just find this whole area confusing,
And that's fine to talk about when we're all sitting here talking in committee and there's different panels everywhere. But at the end of the day, there's people going to be very much affected by what eventually is legislated here. And I don't know what I'm going to try and ask you to do. Could you just tell us what to do? What's your view on that? What's your view on the potential now for simplifying this and making it more cohesive overall at the stage where we are at just now in the legislative process?
Right. Well, in reality, I think probably not much. I mean, my strong sense from talking to officials in the UK government is they're not going to change anything. Somebody did say to me, we're too far down the process to be tearing it up and starting again. So I think whilst amendments are possible, I think where there is an issue about the entire approach that's been adopted, I think we're probably stuck with it, which is very, very unsatisfactory. I mean, I would agree with you. I think, as I said in my written evidence, I think the way in which we're approaching this, you know, the authority that's been given to the Smith Commission Agreement, and you know, no offence to the members here who are on the Commission, but it's highly problematic given the nature of that process. Very rushed, a political bargain, very, very little public involvement. Now that is being used as the kind of the measure of what goes, of what can be done in the parliamentary stages. You know, this far and no further is really problematic, because this is the point at which, you know, we're supposed to be scrutinising this bill and supposed to be working out whether it works or not. So, you know, we're allowing an earlier flawed process to now hamper a later part of the process. Mm-hmm. 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 I mean, on the specific issue about devolved benefits that you or the top benefits in devolved areas, I mean, mm-hmm. I'm not a huge expert on this, but I did look at it in the last few days, and I mean, my view on this was well, there's scope for disagreement here. So why not make it clear? What's the objection to putting something beyond doubt? Because that should prevent disputes in the future. I don't understand why you wouldn't do that if you had the opportunity to do it.
Mm-hmm. So one final wee thing, just really just to get on record that the Scotland office is, I presume, spending a lot of money just now with adverts saying the terms of the Smith Agreement are being met. Would that be your view?
I'm not. Some areas clearly yes, some areas clearly no, and in other areas, you know, your guess is as good as mine. And as I've made at the point in my submission, the Smith Commission is rather vague on these points, and an arguable case might be made, to sound a bit lawyerly, that a number of different areas are met. The critical question, I agree entirely with what Aileen just said. I think we have to shift from a question simply of is it met or not to a question of does this make sense or not, yes. Particularly in welfare powers,
absolutely.
For example. If we have a legal challenge emerging, which is quite probable in the sense this Parliament has seen a number of its acts challenged in courts, not only on ECHR grounds, EU law grounds, but also in the sense that your legislation relates to reserved matters. If you have a convoluted scheme of welfare in Schedule 5 with exceptions on exceptions, then you can bet your bottom dollar that you will find your case in court brought by somebody.
I think it's back, Convener, to spirit and intent. Yeah.
Davish.
It does strike me occasionally that I remember lots of academics saying that Kalman was too slow and now this is too rushed. Maybe we should just get you guys to write all this and then politicians should just entirely give up altogether. Maybe I could ask two questions. The first is about Andrew Tickle's remark that the welfare clauses would give rise to litigation. Do you want to quantify that? Because governments don't go into court against each other, do they?
No. In terms of, well, they could potentially, although that's not to be ruled out. My name is Tickell, by the way. My father would insist on me correcting that. It just makes you sound absurd, and I'm absurd enough already. In terms of that, we have to think about standing in Scots law to bring actions in review of your acts has been expanded very significantly by the AXA case, which you all know is the plural plaques case, has expanded very significantly. So we're not necessarily talking about one government challenging another. Imagine, for example, this Parliament passed an act.
I just wanted to be very precise about the evidence you gave earlier on, in which you said the government that the welfare clauses as drafted could lead to litigation.
Yes.
I'm just suggesting to you the intergovernmental machinery that this committee is also taking a lot of evidence on is designed to make sure that doesn't happen, and governments don't go to court and will not go to court in a practical sense on this either, will they not?
No, my point, sorry, I perhaps didn't make myself clear. My point is that an ordinary member of the public, a pressure group, a campaigning group, the Christian Institute, AXA, all of these organisations, they can review your acts in Scottish courts. Mm-hmm. So, for example, the disability clauses as they stand say that a disability benefit created by this Parliament has to be significant. Now, significant is a pretty vague phrase. Mm-hmm. If this Parliament introduces such a bill about disability and somebody out there disagrees with it, that can be reviewed in the Court of Session. So I'm not suggesting, I suppose, that it's the government's, but yeah, any member of the public may well avail himself of that.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. That's helpful. Thank you for that. I really wanted to ask Professor McLean about his paper, some of which I understood and some of which, frankly, I didn't, if I may say so. And the bit that got me was about horizontal fiscal equalisation. Point 11 of your paper, Professor McLean, you say this means, and you'll need to take us through this, this means a transfer of resources from relatively rich people to relatively poor ones, and hence from relatively rich parts of a country to relatively poor ones. Could you say what you mean by that in the context of what we're discussing?
Yes, I'll do my best, colleagues. Suppose we consider the case not of Scotland, but of Wales and Northern Ireland, because it's quite clear that these are relatively poor regions of the UK.
But we are considering Scotland with great respect.
Yes, but
really
for the purposes of answering your...
Forgive me, you're giving evidence to a Scottish parliamentary committee. We're not discussing Wales and Northern Ireland, we're discussing Scotland and the Smith Commission, so I really like the answer to relate to us, please.
Very well, then. In relation to Scotland, Scottish GDP per head is about 96% of UK average. Scottish public spending per head is about 115%. Mm-hmm. Now, there are possibly some anomalies there, but if we maintain a social union and Scotland remains part of the United Kingdom, then that 96% suggests that on average there are somewhat more poor people or people in difficult circumstances per 1,000 of population in Scotland than there are in the rest of the UK. On average, also, there are fewer higher rate taxpayers in Scotland than the rest of the UK. Therefore, within a social union, there will have to be some transfers. Therefore, can never be the case that the Scottish Parliament can be expected to raise all that it spends. It will raise less per head in tax, and it will have more requirement to spend on welfare benefits. Mm-hmm. The only reason for proposing to bring Wales and Northern Ireland into the discussion is that the issues are much more clear-cut because they are of the order of 80% per head GDP.
So the convener's question about the fiscal framework, you'd agree that that's absolutely the nub of this issue?
For me it is. That's not to disregard the legal points which other colleagues are here to address.
And do you have a view about how that fiscal framework needs to work or how it can best be constructed?
This is not in the bill, it's in the intergovernmental negotiations about which I know very little.
Which is stuff that really matters in all of this.
Yeah. There's a lot of stuff that really matters there. It's sort of clear what the no detriment principles mean on day one of the transfer of a tax power. Yeah. It's not at all clear to me that what they mean, if you will, in year two. And in that respect, if I were answering Linda Fabiani's question about is Smith being implemented or not, I would have to say, I don't know, because I don't know how or even whether the no detriment principles are to be implemented.
And do you think, that's very helpful, do you think the no detriment principle is a principle that applies over a parliamentary period, i.e. a parliament, or is it over a spending review period, or do you think those definitions matter? Have you done any work on assessing how that might operate?
Oh, they matter a great deal. If it were, for instance, if you will, locked into a spending review period, then the risks, the downside risks and the upside rewards are less than if it were done annually, because were the GDP per head of one part of the country to grow less than the other, that might be protected for a whole spending review period. But if it were done annually, it presumably would not be.
Yeah, so you'd favour, or you think it would be more fiscally responsible to take the longer view than the year-to-year, short-term view in terms of how that was constructed?
I'm not sure what I would favour because I'm not sure whose interests I would be expected to be looking at.
In this context, the taxpayer, shall we say?
Yes, yeah. But am I looking at the position of the Scottish taxpayer or the rest of the UK taxpayer? They might, in some unfortunate circumstances, be actually opposite. And so I don't think I can answer that question.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
So I'm going to come back into deeper issues to do with the fiscal framework later, but I do need to get... I know Alison Johnson has got particular time pressures, so let me make sure Alison gets the opportunity to raise the issues she wishes to do so. Alison.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'd like to ask Andrew Tickell about a couple of blogs that you've written recently that have been very interesting regarding the UK government's plans to repeal the Human Rights Act and the impact that might have on ECHR requirements on the devolved nations. So if I could just ask you two or three questions that might enable you to elaborate. Is it your view that repeal of the Human Rights Act doesn't require Sewell consent? And is it your view that while we should lament and campaign against this repeal, we might perhaps be better to push forward with our own version? And also, I'd be interested to learn your views on whether or not a British Bill of Rights would require consent from this Parliament. Thank you.
Plenty there, and I imagine Aileen can speak to these points too, and I think we may disagree on one or two of these things. Point one, does the repeal of the Human Rights Act require Sewell consent from this Parliament? There's an argument that it does, I think quite a strong argument that it does, from a few different points. Iain Jameson, who's a former Scottish Government lawyer, has made the point that the Human Rights Act is the dictionary of the Scotland Act. And as you'll know, the ECHR provisions in the Scotland Act are different from the Human Rights Act. They will apply whether or not the Human Rights Act across the UK is repealed. So there's an argument, I think a strong argument, that actually the consent of this Parliament is necessary for repeal, full stop. It will alter the competencies of this Parliament. It will impact on what you can and cannot legislate for. And that engages Sewell as it has presently been understood. To do with your third point, I think a British Bill of Rights clearly would require the consent of this Parliament. Human rights are not a reserved matter under Schedule 5 of the Scotland Act. I think the UK government has been profoundly confusing in its statements in public about whether or not it regards either repeal or replacement as requiring the consent of this Parliament. Michael Gove has seemed to suggest that it doesn't. I think he's probably mistaken in that judgment. To be honest, I think the UK government shows very little evidence of having thought at all about the devolved aspect of this proposal. It dominated the Bill of Rights Commission, which was abortive, the Lib Dem Tory Bill of Rights Commission, but it's been really missing from the government's analysis since. Your second point, should we replace it with the Scottish Bill of Rights? That might be an idea. It would be an interesting idea. We could replace it with different sets of rights, children's rights, for example, but it would have limits. It would have limits in the sense that it wouldn't apply to every single public authority in this country, as the Human Rights Act currently does, every school, every hospital, every local authority.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, thank you. I don't think I do disagree with Andrew as much as he thinks I did. I mean, my initial view on your first question, does repeal of the Human Rights Act require Sewell? My initial view was that it doesn't, because the Human Rights Act is specifically a reserved statute under Schedule 4 of the Act. But I have been persuaded by what other people have said subsequently, particularly Iain Jameson's views on this, that yes, it does. It is more intertwined in the Scotland Act, and therefore I think there is certainly an argument that Sewell is required. I certainly agree with Andrew, for a British Bill of Rights, Sewell would definitely be engaged. Is it better to push forward on our own version? I see no problem in principle with this. You know, there is a kind of view that, well, human rights are part of the UK constitution. They should be the same throughout the UK. But the truth is they're not at the moment. They're not the same. They are the level of protection for convention rights varies from country to country, and the way in which we protect rights more substantively, because, of course, rights are not just protected by the ECHR, they're protected in legislation. So the practical protection of rights varies quite substantially from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. And I see no problem with that in principle. I have some concerns, as a little bit of a rights skeptic, I have some concerns about the idea that we should just, you know,
you know, this is a great opportunity. Let's entrench everything. Let's have lots of socioeconomic rights. I'd be a little bit concerned about that. The point that Andrew made about what about reserved public authorities? Would we be able to include them within a Scottish Bill of Rights? I think there's a little bit of an argument that possibly we could. We might regard this as an alteration of Scots private law. Scots private law is defined in the Scotland Act rather problematically as including judicial review, which is not private law. But we could frame this as an alteration to the grounds of judicial review, and it might be arguable that we could include reserve public authorities in that. But I wouldn't be confident about it. So I think there is a risk of a bespoke Scottish system that, yes, it might be much stronger and better in its content, but much narrower in its scope, and that would be a loss. I mean, if you think of where many of the human rights challenges come, for instance, immigration cases, well, you know, if that is out with the competence of the Scottish Parliament, then that would be a huge narrowing of the scope for human rights challenge in this country.
Thank you. Could I ask one more quick question, Convener?
It's not quite as tangential as that particular bit was.
Well, I do think it's a very important question. It just seems to me such a hugely important issue. I wonder if you have a view on the political implications of Westminster going ahead without the consent of this Parliament, because it will be massively contentious.
Well, I mean, yes, of course it would be. It would be, I think many people would regard it as outrageous, frankly, in the sense that the Sewell Convention is a constitutional principle. It would be, some people would say, an unconstitutional act by the Westminster government to do that, if I'm correct, and if Aileen is correct on the points that were mentioned.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Do you agree with that, Aileen?
I do, and I think that, it's Northern Ireland you need to be really concerned about, not here.
Okay. I'll move into a slightly different area, although probably linked. Malcolm?
Well, I did want to, and I will ask about Sue more generally, but if you'll just allow me for a few minutes, you might regard it as tangential, but I'm really intrigued by another quote from an earlier blog of Andrew Tickell, where he said, if Westminster abolishes the Human Rights Act, Holyrood and the Scottish Government will remain bound over to observe convention rights, but Glasgow City Council and the police will be liberated from their obligations to respect freedom of religion and conscience and the privacy and home life of everybody they encounter. So I wasn't quite sure why that was the case, given that they're legislatively, we are responsible for local government and the police.
I'm being quoted up. I better hope my record's all as pure as that. The point is a distinction between the two human rights regimes which apply in Scotland. So this Parliament cannot legislate contrary to the European Convention under the Scotland Act. The Scottish Government must observe convention rights under the Scotland Act. But the Human Rights Act casts its net much more widely to incorporate those bodies that you've just described, hospitals, schools, the police officers. So if the Human Rights Act was abolished, and it's worth remembering that Westminster could do that, it might be a constitutional abomination, but it could do it, then it would mean that this Parliament would still be bound by the ECHR, but Glasgow City Council would not.
And, well, I mean, it was a very striking quote, so I think the convener's forgiven me for pursuing that line briefly. But I was interested really in the Sewell issues more generally, because obviously the intention of Smith is to give us more powers, but it appears from the way that Sewell's being dealt with that we're possibly getting less powers. And I was interested in the issues of towards the end of Andrew Tickell's paper, he quotes from the Scottish Parliament standing orders, in fact, but the key phrase is being something which alters the legislative competence or the executive competence of the Scottish ministers. And I wasn't aware of particularly of the executive competence change, but could you just explain, I suppose the more general point would be, in which ways you think we're going to have less powers than we currently have if those aspects of Sewell are overlooked?
Well, it's quite odd. I mean, clause 2 of the bill, which sets out to recognise, in inverted commas, what's been called the Sewell Convention, though I dare say with recent developments we might want to call it something else now. That sets out the principle that Westminster will not normally legislate with respect to devolved matters. Now, devolved matters is not actually a term which we use in the Scotland Bill in general. We talk about reserved matters, and all that is not reserved is devolved. Now, the Sewell Convention has developed over time to extend not just to Westminster legislating about devolved powers, but also changing your powers. That's what we're here discussing. On my interpretation, if the Scotland Bill was in force today, we wouldn't be sitting around discussing this, because the Scotland Bill is not a devolved matter. It's a reserved matter. Now, that seems, I think I described it as chimerical. It's a much more limited understanding of what the Constitution expects than I think the Scottish standing orders that you alluded to express.
And could you say something about the executive competence? Because you're suggesting some of that is actually going to change in relation to energy and another example.
Well, those are two different kinds of questions. So there's the executive competence sections of the bill, which will make the Scottish Government responsible for decision making in certain areas. So it will extend powers from UK government to the Scottish Government. But generally speaking, with Sewell, we're talking about changes to the Scottish Government's powers. So say down the line, an act of the Westminster Government proposed to strip the Scottish Government of certain executive powers. The question is, would that require this Parliament's consent? Under your standing orders definition of Sewell, it would. Under the Scotland Bill's definition, it arguably wouldn't. But then again, we don't know what this magic phrase devolved matters means, because it's nowhere defined in the bill.
Can we ask Aileen to reflect on some of that as well? Could we?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with what Andrew has said. If you want an example of where this Parliament's consent has been required to changing executive competence, an example would be what became the Energy Act 2013, which took away this Parliament's, the Scottish Government's powers to set the renewable obligation in Scotland when that was being changed. For it was replaced with contracts for differences. So that's an example where that wider sense of what Sewell requires has been implemented. In terms of legislative powers, of course, the Scotland Act 2012 was subject to two legislative consent motions in this Parliament. So there is, if we understand conventions as constituted by practice rather than words, then practice tells us that the Sewell is wider than what is currently in the current Scotland Bill. I mean, the question is then, well, if Clause 2 is merely a sort of declaratory clause, if it doesn't have any legal effect, and I would argue that as currently drafted it doesn't, that doesn't necessarily mean that the other bit of Sewell doesn't still apply. The problem is that the statutory statement is likely to become the more authoritative understanding of what it means. So there is a risk that the other bit of Sewell atrophies. I think that would be the risk.
And in terms of the legislative competence, can you give examples of that where it has applied and where it wouldn't apply in the future necessarily?
Well, as Andrew said, that you wouldn't be being asked for consent to this bill, because changing the scope of changing the boundary between reserved and devolved matters is not a devolved matter.
And could you think of any examples where we have been asked?
Scotland Act 2012.
Right. Okay.
Stuart, I know you were interested in this area, but have your questions been answered, or do you want to probe a bit further?
Just a wee area, if it's all right. When I came in here this morning, I didn't think we'd be discussing a Bill of Rights, whether a UK or a Scottish, but it certainly got me to thinking, particularly after I heard from those given evidence this morning. With the proposals in the current Scotland Bill regarding the devolution of some of the welfare powers to come to here, and if there were to be that discussion regarding a Bill of Rights, how would that actually affect this place in terms of actually taking any decisions over some of the welfare powers, or how would it also affect an LCM if the UK government at some point in the future wanted to change or amend or abolish the Human Rights Act?
That's, it feels extremely hypothetical, hypothetical on hypotheticals. I'm not, if you could narrow it down to possibly something more specific, I might be able to be more helpful.
But, well, certainly, with the bill that's in front of us, the Scotland Bill, and also with the devolution office, some of the welfare powers, I mean, we've had a bit of a discussion already this morning regarding some elements of them, and also this committee has widely discussed the issue of the welfare powers in terms of some of the potential confusion or potential restriction placed, that will be placed upon this place. And I'm just thinking that in terms of if we really, if a UK government in the future just wanted to make any major amendments to kind of welfare powers through maybe a different means, not a direct change to it, how would this place be affected? Would we still, if what's suggested with the Scotland Bill regarding the SUL proposal, how would this place be affected by that?
Right, so that would be a question of taking back devolved competences, is that what you're talking about? Or extending devolved competences or recasting them in some way?
Yeah,
I mean, that's the sort of thing that is covered by the second bit of SUL. So what, the bit of SUL that's in the Scotland Bill would cover a situation where Westminster decided to go ahead anyway, notwithstanding the devolution of welfare powers to this Parliament, decided to go ahead anyway and legislate. For instance, as was threatened in relation to Northern Ireland just last week, that, you know, if the Northern Ireland executive couldn't agree on a social security settlement, Westminster would step in and impose one. Right? That's unproblematic. But if you're talking about adjusting the boundaries, yes, that comes under the second bit of SUL, and that's the bit that we're not, that is not clearly catered for under Clause 2 as it currently stands.
Of the SUL stuff, just to get on the record how important you feel it is that all three strands of the SUL defined in DG Note 10 are fully reflected in the bill, in Clause 2 of the bill.
I think that it only at the moment covers the situation where Westminster would be exercising its rights to legislate in an area which has been devolved to this Parliament.
Okay.
I think it only clearly does that.
So the other bits are missing?
I think so.
Okay. Andrew, you feel the same?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's on the record. We know where we are. Mark.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to look at a little bit at the fiscal framework and perhaps some of the financial elements of the legislation as well. So the Secretary of State was before us on the 25th of June, and in his evidence to the committee in answer to a question I posed about the flexibility allowed within the fiscal framework, he said, it is not the intention that the fiscal framework should constrain the powers that are being devolved in the bill. However, if I look at point 2.2.5 of the command paper, I find the sentence, in the context of Scottish devolution, the fiscal framework must ensure that Scotland contributes proportionally to the overall fiscal consolidation pursued by the UK government. And perhaps, Professor McLean, you can, do you feel that those two statements sit side by side? They seem contradictory.
I agree that they seem contradictory, and I think it really takes us back to the set of questions the convener asked at the start of this session. You cannot square the circle. In the case where the worst case from the point of view of Scotland, where Scottish GDP and therefore Scottish tax revenue grows more slowly than rest of the UK GDP, and Smith, no detriment, operates both ways in both parliaments, UK Parliament has to, I think, while we remain in a United Kingdom, to be able to say Scotland cannot increase its deficit, for instance, by more than the UK does. So my reading of that is that that is a consequence of a remaining United Kingdom, which the majority voted for last September. As to contradictions between that and what the Secretary of State said, I can't speak for the Secretary of State.
Possibly a wise approach to take. I don't know if Professor McCarg or Dr. Tickell have anything they would wish to add on that.
I suppose just the kind of technical point that you can have something in legislation will always trump as a matter of law something that's not in legislation, but we need to be aware that what the legislation says is not always what actually matters in practice, and there are other ways of enforcing things that may be included in non-statutory frameworks. So, mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, I guess it does come down to the point that was made about I think it was Andrew Tickell who said that while we have the legislation going forward, we also have the negotiations that are taking place around the fiscal framework. But I was interested, looking more broadly, Convener, at the financial powers, as it were, that will come to Scotland, and it ties into the coherence point that my colleague Linda Fabiani mentioned. And Professor McLean, you've expressed a view that perhaps the suite of taxation powers that are coming to Scotland do not sit, I would say maybe not sit well, but do not seem to match the aspirations that could be achieved via some of the policy instruments. Essentially, that if you take income tax, for example, there are limitations to how many things one can do with income tax in order to derive the revenues to make policy decisions, compared to perhaps other taxation powers. I don't know if you would want to put some of that on record.
That wasn't exactly my point. My point was that the tax powers in total are still less than the spending powers in total, and therefore there is still an imbalance. I wasn't expressing an opinion on which tax powers were best used for which policy purposes, except to a limited extent in my paper in paragraph 20 about sin taxes, fuel taxes and excise, which clearly can be used as policy instruments, but they give rise to the classic problem that the more successful you are at stopping the behaviour you want to stop, the less you raise in the tax.
In fairness, though, you do in your paper talk about taxes which would be what you describe as candidates for further devolution, and particular you've highlighted the full assignment of VAT as opposed to the partial assignment of VAT, and also the devolution of national insurance contributions, which I know has been discussed, because I'm a member of the Finance Committee, has been discussed there about the completeness that would provide in terms of the income tax provisions. I don't know if you want to maybe comment on either or both of those.
I mentioned those simply because they bring more into balance the tax and the spending. But VAT is an example of, as I say in my paper, that you could devolve, you could assign the whole of VAT receipts in Scotland to the Scottish Government. But it would make not a blind bit of difference to the policy powers, the policy levers which this Parliament can pull, because it's an assignment, not a devolution. In a sense, I think the same about the big ones, national insurance contributions, either employers or employees. The ones where I think devolution of tax gives you policy levers are excises and fuel duties, as I've already mentioned, and since it came up earlier in the discussion, I'll also mention both offshore and onshore mineral taxation, where you would be given policy levers if those taxes were devolved.
Okay. In terms of the sort of broader point about the coherence and the relationship between the levers available and the powers available, I don't know if Professor McHarg or Dr. Tickell have anything they want to contribute on that. No, seeing shakes of the head.
Just in this area, do you want to pick up on any issues at this stage?
A couple of things, a bit of a mopping up operation. But you know, in the simplest form, I've always taken the view that devolution of powers to Scotland should be basically in the devolved areas. You can do what you like as long as you pay for it yourself. Are you telling us that within the proposed Scotland Act, that the profiles don't match in order to achieve that outcome?
If that's a question for me, correct. The profiles don't match, although they are closer to matching than either of the previous Scotland Acts, 1998 and 2012.
One of the things, of course, that we do regularly is we assume that every stab we have at devolution is going to be the final chapter in the book. And, of course, it never is. and each attempt produces hostages to fortune. So are we in a position where we need to take action now to avoid hostages to fortune when the next round of devolution and the next final chapter is being written?
That's almost a political question, Convener. I will take refuge in the wise statement of the First Secretary of State for Wales, Ron Davies, that devolution is a process, not an event.
Indeed. And on that subject of a process, this is one of the areas that we actually touched quite heavily on earlier, and I wanted to have a final question on it. And that is that the nature of the Act and in relation to the fiscal framework in particular, which we have little or no control over, do you see what we achieve as being something which can be an ongoing process, or will the effect, particularly in relation to no detriment, be that we have a snapshot on day one that may be clearly definable as functional, but that it will be inflexible going forward and therefore will only ever work on day one?
That's really tricky because none of us around this table knows what no detriment means. I refer you to the earlier discussion between myself and Tavish Scott. If over what time period are the no detriment principles to be set and reset, we don't know. And so with respect, I find that question impossible to answer, and I apologise for that.
The final thing I wanted to ask is that relates to a very specific comment you made in your very opening remarks, and that was when you were talking about the relationship between powers and taxation. You said that, and I'm paraphrasing very heavily here, you said it was relatively simple to work out what a welfare power was, but you mentioned something which you described as a welfare tax. Now, I wanted to explore what you meant by a welfare tax.
Nominally, since 1911, national insurance contributions have been a welfare tax. They are nominally linked to a national insurance fund. Now, you might say that this was a fraud from day one, and that Lloyd George, who began this, knew very well that it's a fraud. There's a famous book called Lloyd George's Ambulance Wagon, which shows that he knew exactly what he was doing. He was creating a pay-as-you-go system. But if I gave the impression that I thought that the link was any more than nominal, I probably should not have done. But nominally, there is a link between national insurance contributions and welfare benefits.
So you were talking in a fairly general sense rather than suggesting anything that would appear to be the hypothecation of taxation.
Well, everybody around this room knows that the UK Treasury has a panic fear of hypothecation of taxation. And I don't think that really is coming up as much of an issue in this bill or in the fiscal framework discussions, to the best of my knowledge.
But it simply would appear that if we achieve all we want to achieve in terms of the ability to create new benefits, for example, in devolved areas, that you're concerned that the necessary tax powers in order to achieve that are not contained within the bill?
My concern was expressed at a more general level,
yes,
that apart from what is needed to redistribute within a social union, I would prefer if the tax power, the power to tax, amounted to the same proportion of public expenditure as the power to spend. That's just a neutral principle. It's not saying anything about any particular tax.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Just to sweep this session up before I go to Rob Gibson, would you agree with this committee in terms of the fiscal framework that as it's developed, there should be more transparency around the process so that parliaments can understand what the fiscal framework means when it gets there, and we should have the chance to scrutinise draft elements of the fiscal framework before they are set in stone, and that Parliament should agree them, both Parliaments should agree them, the fiscal framework before it's signed off, because from what we're hearing this morning, it's now the absolute central documentation and framework that's going to decide whether this is going to work or not.
At the end of the process, this Parliament has to decide whether or not to give legislative consent to this bill. I find it difficult to see how this Parliament can decide either way unless it knows something about the fiscal framework, so I would agree with that, Convener.
Okay. Aileen, Andrew?
Yeah, I would agree as well.
Yes, you can't calculate what this bill will do until you know that.
Okay, thank you. Rob.
Good morning. panel turn to the devolution of the Crown Estate, which both Aileen McCarg and Iain McLean have commented upon. From both the point of view of process and then the use of assets, Aileen McCarg has said that there's even greater complexity in the devolution arrangements in the bill as compared to the draft clauses, and indeed that it's not entirely clear how the Scottish Parliament's powers to alter the management of the transferred assets contained in clauses 31.2 and 31.6 will be affected by any restrictions in the transfer scheme itself, in particular regarding clause 31.10. I wonder if you'd like to explore a bit for us how you think 31.10 constrains these previous bits, or how it might be altered.
Okay, so clause 31.10 is the bit that says the Crown Estate has to be maintained as an estate in land. Okay, so my first reaction to that is, what on earth is an estate in land? It's a term which currently appears in the Crown Estate Act 1961, but it's not a term of art in Scots law. So that's a problem. I asked an Australian colleague a few weeks ago. She's a property lawyer, and an Australian property law is based on English law, so this is an English law term of art. And I asked her, what does this mean? She said, oh, yes, that's a very good question. So I was not really any the wiser, unfortunately. It seems to be some idea that there has to be something that is maintained in Crown ownership. It doesn't have to be what's currently in the Crown Estate, so assets can be sold or added, but there has to be something which is a Crown Estate, which I find a really odd idea. I don't understand, or the justification that's given for it, I don't think makes sense historically. The argument seems to be that the Crown is indivisible, therefore Crown property is indivisible. This is historic property of the sovereign, and it must be maintained in trust for the sovereign. This seems to me to be a lot of nonsense. And, you know, this is Crown estate property is government property. Things that are included or not included in the Crown Estate are, to some extent, random. And if we look at offshore energy rights, for instance, the rights to grant leases for offshore gas storage, offshore renewables, have been added recently by statute to the Crown Estate. Oil and gas pipelines also are Crown Estate, added by statute. Oil and gas drilling offshore never had anything to do with the Crown Estate. You know, it's still a Crown right, but it's not Crown Estate. It's got nothing historically to do with the sovereign. It's just government property. This is a device by which we manage government property. There may be a case for maintaining government property, but there may be a case for doing something else with it. And I just don't see any argument for imposing that restriction on the Scottish Parliament. If you want to give away Crown property, I think you should be free to do so.
Indeed, the transfer of Stirling Castle grounds, I think, was one of the interesting recent examples of where the Crown Estate made an agreement with the Scottish Government and Parliament.
Right, well, some Crown property is already devolved. So not in Scotland, not all Crown property in Scotland is Crown Estate. It's completely haphazard.
So what you're suggesting is probably that Clause 31.10 should be scrapped.
I would say so, yes.
I wonder if we could bring in Iain McLean at this point, because you talk about the consequences not being specified in your paper about Scottish ministers deciding how to treat treat the Crown assets in different ways. It follows on from this. Do you think that these restrictions should be abolished in 31.10?
Not being a lawyer, I'd rather not attempt to second-guess what Aileen has just said about 31.10. So I'm simply taking the statement in the bill explanatory notes, which I quote in my paragraph 7, at face value, and I'm making a different point to Aileen's, namely that if Scottish ministers use the freedom that it said that the bill grants them, and whether it actually does grant them that freedom or not, I'm not qualified to say, but let's assume that it does. then that's a policy change, and therefore, under the Smith no detriment principles, the rest of the UK could play hardball and say, you have reduced the revenue which comes to you from the Crown Estate, you must bear the risk of that. And I'm simply pointing out that that is a risk to this Parliament of using the powers in that way. That's not to say it's the wrong thing to do, it's just a risk.
But it's only an example of saying, using a less commercial approach, for example, increasing the role of social enterprise, but it could be in adding to the estate through various taxes and offshore renewables or oil and gas. It could be actually different, but the example that's been given suggests that the Scottish Government would take less from the Crown Estate. Why doesn't it suggest it could take more?
I'm just going with the example given. Well, the consequences of the example given in that explanatory note is that the Scottish Government would take less. And I'm simply saying that this could give rise to a claim from the rest of the UK. It might be trivial in proportion to the total of public expenditure, but it could. I should say that I speak in one of my hats as a trustee of a body, the British Academy, which is a tenant of the Crown Estate, and I'm very well aware that the Crown Estate is as hard-nosed as any landlord you will get. And, you know, as a private citizen, I would be delighted were the Scottish Government to take the approach which is suggested that it could in that explanatory note, but there would be fiscal consequences.
Okay.
I've got a feeling you want to contribute.
Yeah, I mean, there is an irony in this, that in the transfer scheme, one of the restrictions that is to be imposed is restrictions to ensure that that we can't fleece UK energy consumers by upping rents for offshore renewables or pipelines. But no such restriction on the powers of the Crown Estate in England. But as Ian has just said, they act in a wholly commercial manner. It's there's a real inconsistency there. I don't understand why the Scottish ministers in control of these assets are any less to be trusted than the Crown Estate. If there's a problem, it's already a problem.
The Crown Estate assets include the revenues from offshore wind and things like that. And in fact, the UK government has changed the potential income from these by constraining the number of offshore wind developments there might be. So the Crown Estate, in investing its income in further income gathering projects, actually is already detrimental, perhaps, to Scotland's ability to gain income from the offshore estate. Do you think that that's something which the no detriment principles would have to take into account? Because although it's, you know, decisions, no detriment as a result of the decision to devolve further power, okay, that doesn't apply. But then the no detriment as a result of the UK government or Scottish government policy decisions post-devolution. But, you know, already we're talking about things that have been constrained before we get to that stage, Iain McLean.
This is, and I am not a lawyer, but answer, and you have two lawyers sitting to my left. But if the Crown Estate in Scotland, in and on the foreshore in Scotland, controls, among other things, facilities to do with offshore wind, then it seems to me Scottish ministers have under this bill the power to direct the Crown Estate to do the opposite of what it says in this illustrative note, and to act in a more commercial manner, to allow more offshore wind to be developed off the Scottish coast. And in that case, the no detriment principle still works, but it means the policy changes in Scotland, and if there are more tax receipts as a result of a directive to the Crown Estate Commissioners, then this Parliament gets to keep them.
Indeed. So do you think that the restrictions in Clause 3110 should be scrapped?
I must defer to the lawyers here.
Okay. Yes, it has, but...
The lawyers have already said yes to that question.
Yes, I know that.
OK, well, thank you very much. I think that's been a very useful session, very informative from the committee's perspective. Very grateful for Iain, Aileen and Andrew coming along and giving us evidence today. Thank you very much. I now close this and we move on to private session.